Hi, I'm Bram Claeys with the Power Team of the Regulatory Assistance Project in Brussels. Today, the topic is the electricity market reform. It just got adopted, so it's a good time to look back and also look forward. So here we go. Now, the electricity market reform is, of course, one of the reactions to the gas crisis in 2022, which also impacted very much the power sector. Was a result of Russia invading Ukraine. Now, throughout this crisis, the European institutions came out with a series of packages to reduce our dependence on fossil fuel imports from Russia, increase renewables, increase flexibility. But throughout this period, fundamental discussions were happening around the core market functioning of the electricity market. Which led the Commission, the European Commission, after a public consultation, to come out with a proposal of electricity market reform at the beginning of 2023, at a point when gas and electricity prices had already substantially started coming down. Now, that proposal has been discussed extensively, but very swiftly with the Council and the Parliament, leading to a deal on electricity market reform by the end of 2023, which then got adopted first by the Parliament and then very recently, 21st of May, in the Council. All right, what's in the deal? There's a lot in here. It's an evolution of the existing market design, not a revolution. It's not a complete overhaul that some were calling for. And indeed, the evidence did point out that the market fundamentals did function as they should have throughout the crisis. And the crisis was due to other things like our over-reliance on fossil fuels, failing nuclear in France, and also failing hydro because of a very dry summer. But a lot of amendments to the existing regulation and directive, so inevitably also positive and negative elements. From our perspective as RAP, we would definitely see improvements on grid governance, use of local flexibility, more transparency as a big plus, as well as better consumer protection. There's now a ban on disconnections, and there's also a lot more guidance on how to engage in energy sharing and what your rights are as prosumers are. And this was a very important point for the European Parliament. So that's really good. On core market design, there's also improvements. Gate closure times on the intraday market are shortened, which is helpful for the integration of variable renewables. And a lot of attention, of course, went to long-term contracts, either private contracts, PPAs, power purchase agreements, or public contracts with a public entity, in which case we're talking about double-sided contracts for difference. Now, we would have liked to see more focus on what kind of contracts parties should engage in. That was left more open, so that's a bit of a missed opportunity, but fortunately the language is quite clear on what those long-term contracts should achieve in terms of system integration, price responsiveness, and also what should be done with revenues that are coming out of those long-term contracts. Now, they are meant for new investments, a whole discussion around CFDs for existing nuclear didn't go anywhere, and so those are not mentioned and are left open to the member states to decide if they can get approval from DG Competition. And then a big new thing is this flexibility assessment that every member state is going to have to do, figuring out how much non-fossil flexibility they can mobilize and how to do that. And that's, of course, to reduce the importance of fossil gas power plants. So that's really going to be something to look out for. And then on the negative is the capacity mechanisms. They are made permanent. Despite being a market distortion. So we do recognize that they have a role to play, but making them permanent, I think, is not the best of ideas, as well as opening the door for extending the use of capacity mechanisms for coal and lignite plants, which is potentially the result of this CO2 emissions performance standard derogation. We'll see if and how many countries make use of that. Hopefully not too many. Now, what's next? Well, here's what's next, or at least part of it. And the EMD is a regulation and directive that all needs to get implemented. The regulation is effective immediately. The directive needs to be transposed in national legislation. But there's also bits and pieces in the EMD that have a clear deadline and also somebody that is responsible for meeting that deadline. And that's what this graph, I had a lot of fun pulling this together, is trying to explain. The colors are different entities that are responsible. It's the Commission in blue, ACER, the European Agency for Energy Regulators. In yellow, in green, we've got the grid operators, ENTSO-E and the EU DSO body. Then the national level in pink, and the market operators in red. It of course all starts now, or at least in June 2024, when the EMD enters into force. And then you can start and follow what needs to happen. As a matter of fact, one of the very first things is this assessment by ACER of standard voluntary power purchase agreements. That already needs to happen by September 24. But probably the most interesting and convoluted process is this whole flexibility assessment to determine how much non-fossil flexibility can be used in the electricity system. That starts with a proposal by ENTSO-E and EU DSO in April 25, goes to ACER to approve and amend it, or amend it, then goes to the national level that needs to use that methodology to assess their flexibility needs at the national level, which then hopefully swiftly leads to a non-fossil flexibility national indicative objective, because it couldn't be called a target. Now, this objective then, of course, gets operationalized by either improving the market to realize the potential for non-fossil flexibility, or putting in place a support scheme if the market can't be improved enough. It also has to be implemented in the National Energy and Climate Plan. Goes back to ENTSO-E to update the 10-year network development plans, and also at the national level needs to be used by grid companies in their network plans. And of course, also the European Commission will look at it to assess whether there is a need for a European flexibility strategy. So very, very interesting. And there's many other things in here. Just maybe one additional thing is this review of the short-term market, which is where a lot of the concerns around the market fundamentals went. The Commission needs to review that by June 26 and also look at how robust the market is against crises. So we'll be having a lot of fun following all of this up. Okay, is this it? Was this the last of the reform cycles of the electricity market in Europe? Probably not. It's not like the electricity market is perfect. But let's first implement the acquis, is what many, I think, would say. There's a lot that needs to get transposed. There's the electricity market design. There's everything else in the Fit for 55 package. There's the grids action plan that needs to be rolled out. So under the next European Commission, there will be probably a lot of focus on things like competitiveness, security, a lot of investments in energy grids and infrastructure, hopefully also a building of trust and solidarity for security of supply, part of one of the big benefits of the integrated energy markets. But that being said, 2035 is around the corner, by which time the power system should be fully zero emissions. So any electricity market gaps that need to be plugged in order to facilitate that should happen in the next legislature. So we'll be very happy to support that. For which the power system blueprint of RAP should be really useful. We pulled together all the existing knowledge on ideal power market regulation to achieve zero emissions by 2035 on this website, blueprint.raponline.org, where you can learn about things like locational pricing and why it's such a big gap in the European market design. So have a look and we'll be in touch. See you later.